The family of First Baptist Church Indian Trail welcomes you. Join with Senior Pastor Dr. Mike Whitson as we present Decision for Life. Welcome to First Baptist Church Indian Trail.
Well, there must be some explanation. Somebody tell me what's happening here. Everywhere I look, the lame are leaping and the blind are seeing clear. Well, I know there's a reason. Somebody tell me how. The only thing I can think of, he must be in the house. He must be in the house. How else can I explain it? The blind can see, the deaf can hear, the lame all walking around. These things all happen when he is near, and I can tell he must be here, his glory all around. He must be in the house. He must be in the house. I know, 'cause I can feel him. I knew when I walked through the door, I had stepped on holy ground. And I know in his presence, eternal joy abounds. He banished all the gloom, there's glory in the room. He must be in the house. How else can I explain it? The blind can see, the deaf can hear, the lame all walking around. These things all happen when he is near, and I can tell he must be here, his glory all round. He must be in the house. Yes, he must be in the house. How else can I explain it? The blind can see and the deaf can hear, the lame all walking around. These things all happen when he is near, and I can tell glory. I feel his glory. Well, I feel his glory. I know he must be in the house. He's in the house.
Amen. Let's stand to our feet. Because every praise belongs to the Lord who is with us this morning. Come on, sing this out now. Come on.
Every praise is to our God.
Every word.
Every word of worship with one accord.
You know it. Every praise.
Every praise.
Every praise.
Every praise
is to our God.
Is to our God.
Sing hallelujah now.
Sing hallelujah to our God.
Glory. Hallelujah. Yes.
Sing hallelujah to our God.
Give him glory, church.
Glory, hallelujah is to our God.
Oh,
every praise.
Every praise.
Every praise is to our God.
Come on, you can lift your hands. Here we go.
We lift our hands in the sanctuary.
That's right, yes, Lord.
We lift our hands.
Come on, sing really loud. Come on.
We sing our song.
Yes, we sing our song.
We sing our song.
We sing our song.
To give you the glory.
We sing our song.
We sing our song to give you
So let's sing this together.
In the presence,
that's right, of Jehovah. He is God Almighty. And he's the Prince of Peace. Oh, there's good news in the house. Come on.
Troubles
and our hearts.
Hearts are mended. In the presence of the King.
Come on, let's sing it loud, church.
In the
get tired of realizing that he is with us in this place. It's one of those things that I love reminding our students about when, you know, when people come and say, what do I do? What do I do? How do I fix this? What I need help. I need counsel. One of the things I love to do is to help, but one of the things really I love to do is I like to do this. Have you asked Jesus yet? Because you know he's real. He's not a fairy tale. He's not some wonderful story. Jesus is a person, and his very presence is in this place. And so when we sing about him, sing to him, the Bible tells us when we gather to do this, you know what he does. He inhabits the praises of his people. And I don't know about you, but I'm looking around at a lot of his people. God bless you for that. And so glad that you're here this morning. And if you would, just go ahead, and if you haven't done this already, look onto your left and to your right and behind you, in front of you, and just let the people around you know you're glad they're here. Yeah, you can do that. You can make some noise doing that. That's okay. I love that. So let's pray. God, you're so good. So good in all of your ways. And Lord, I really am thankful that even in the ways that we don't quite understand, God, you're still good. And even through it, you show us how good you are. And now, Lord, as we continue to worship you through giving of tithes and offerings, we just pray, Lord, you would just be blessed. Because, Lord, we know that as we give, you do this thing called multiply it in a crazy way. And we just thank you for that. And so now, Lord, as we worship you this way, just be blessed. And Lord, help us to remember as we do continue to worship you that you, God, are a shield around us. You are the glory and the lifter of our heads. If anyone in this place this morning, Lord, feels like they should walk around as your children with their head down, I pray that, Lord, they would know that because of you, you lift their face and they can worship you with their faces up because you're good. We love you and we thank you. We really thank you for Jesus, in whose name we pray. And all God's people said, amen. You may be seated as we continue to worship.
Oh, Our God is so worthy to be praised. Amen. Well, thank you for letting me be here. Thank you, Steve, for that introduction. And Sammy, thank you for showing me around today. And I kind of feel home. My daughter works here, and I'm in and out with different things with the school. And so, man, I know a lot about you. And I'm a little discouraged that it took me like 10 years from the last time I preached here to make it back to Flint Groves. I don't know what that says between me and Mike, but man, I appreciate your pastor. Preacher Mike has been a dear friend for all 24, 25 years of my ministry. And I can't tell you how many times I've called him and said, hey, I'm going to do this. And then he goes, well, do you have your resume ready? And no, he said, you're going to need it. Don't do that. I appreciate him so much, and I'm thankful that he has entrusted this place to me today. And God's going to speak to us today, I believe, with all of my heart. And if you have your Bibles in a minute, I want you to turn to the book of Job. That means you're going to get to the Psalms, hang a left, and you're going to be right there in the book of Job. And man, let's just go to the Lord in prayer and ask him to bless our time together before we dive in his word. Father, thank you for who you are. Thank you for the ability, Lord, to study your word together today. God, I pray that you would just unite our hearts, not around us, but God, around you. God, we are already at your throne through worship. And so, God, we ask you now to speak to our hearts in a bold way. God, may we leave this place knowing that we have unmistakably heard from you. God, speak to our hearts today, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, if you have your Bibles, the book of Job, before I dive in there, let me tell you how I got to Job today. It's kind of an interesting thing. My wife couldn't come with me today. She had some women's stuff at our church that she was working on. And so she couldn't come with me. But I'm going to tell you how she contributed to today in just a second. But I also have a friend with me. Y'all have that guy. Don't point at him or anything. But there's always that one guy in church you don't want to leave alone. And so instead of coming by myself so I don't go back into getting into trouble, I brought trouble with me. And so a dear friend of mine, Johnny, is with me today, and I appreciate y'all welcoming him today. And just thank you for allowing me to bring him and not throwing him out before he gets all the way in. But we're in the book of Job today because of my wife. I want to be honest. I rarely ever ask my wife, what I should preach when I go to a place. But 2 weeks ago, we are away on a couple days, and we were just talking back and forth, and I made a mistake. I asked her, honey, what do you think I ought to preach? Is there one thing that has encouraged you? And realize, I've been in the book of Mark for a year and a half. We just finished the book of Mark. We've been in Thessalonians. We've been all kinds of different places over the last couple of years. I preached on the attributes of God, and I thought maybe that's what she'll come up with. She said, well, the most encouraging thing to me was when you preached out of the book of Job. And I said, the book of Job. I said, honey, do you know what the book of Job is about? Yes. And so you're telling me that the one time that I'm going to get to preach an Indian Trail, I'm going to bring out the book of Job. She said, if you're smart. So I am going to preach today out of the book of Job. Now, let me give you her email if you don't like this. It is Norma. No, I'm just kidding. But anyway. But if you have your Bibles, turn to the book of Job. And today, I just want to ask you a real serious question before we get started. I'm not going to ask you to vote or anything like that, but how many of you are really struggling? I mean, you look at life and you're wondering, God, I'm doing everything that I know to do. I'm rising up early, I'm praying, I'm in the Word of God, I'm around other believers, and it just seems like things just keep coming at me. And I have no idea, and maybe you're right on the verge of just saying, why bother? Well, I want you to look into a life of a man today that had every reason to just say, you know what, I've had enough. And so let's just dive in. Let's listen to the description of the man, Job. So if you have Bibles, Job chapter 1, verse 1, listen to what it said. There was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job. And that man was blameless, upright, a man who feared God and turned away from evil. Now, would you say that guy was a righteous man? Are we voting? He's a righteous man, right? He is described with four characteristics. Look at what they say. The first one is blameless. He is upright. He fears God. And he flees evil. Now, I know y'all are not going to pay attention to that, so I'm going to have you back where I'm at. I make my congregation talk. And by the way, if you, the more you talk back to me, the shorter my sermons are. So anyway, and so here's what I want you to say to me. He was what? He was blameless, upright, feared God, fled evil. One more time. He was blameless, he was upright, he feared God, and he fled evil. Now, I want you to hold that in your mind, because in my mind, that would be a man that God would cover him up with his favor, right? Surely this is the man who God would bless, and he does. Listen to how blessed he is. This man was born with had seven sons born to him, three daughters. He possessed 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, 500 female donkeys, and very many servants, so that this man was the greatest of all the people of the East. Now, that's a blessed man. He's a godly man, and he's a blessed man. But listen to his everyday activities. Listen to the way that fleshed out in his life. Listen to what it says. His sons used to go and hold a feast in the house of each one of them on his day. And they would send and invite the three sisters to eat and drink with them. And when the days of the feast had run their course, listen to what Job did. Job would send and consecrate them. And he would rise early in the morning, offer burnt offerings according to the number of them all. For Job, it may be, he thought this way, that it may be that his children have sinned and cursed God in their hearts. Thus he did. Listen to this word. Continually. Say that with me. Continually. We're going to come back to that. So let's just get a picture of Job. I mean, he's blameless, he's upright, he's righteous, he feared God, he fled evil, and he was such a godly man that he would even consecrate and worship and give God everything he possibly could, and he did it on a regular basis. So let me ask you a question. In our world today, wouldn't you think that would be a blessed man? Wouldn't you think God would always have his hand of protection on him? And the truth is, we live in a society today where the prosperity gospel has so crept into our churches that we think that our behavior should allow us to skip out on the pain of the world that we live in. But what I want you to see is that's not the case. I want you to hold in your mind how godly this man was. He was blameless, upright, feared God, fled. He was continually worshiping God. And then we have, to me, one of the most troubling, confusing, difficult conversations ever in the Word of God. Now, before we say that, before we get into it and read it, I want you to think about this way. For me, when I first started pastoring the church that I'm at now, I did what every pastor did. I went into all the houses. I went into all the homes. I was trying to figure out who everybody was. And at that point, there was only 70 of us, so it didn't take me a real long time. And so I was going into this lady's house that I heard, you know, was a little cantankerous. She could be a little hard to deal with and all that. But I went in the back door with her son because he was out in the yard. We get inside, and I'm standing in the kitchen talking to him and his dad, and they say to her, the mom in the other room, "Hey, the preacher is here." And she went, "You know, that new preacher, I don't even like him. He's fat. He can't preach. They say he sweats way too much. But the only good thing about him is he has a beautiful wife." So I stick my head in there and say, "Hey, Barbara, I'm Ronnie." And her husband says he's the new pastor at Flint Groves. And she looked at me and she went, "My name is Barbara Big Mouth." And it was an awkward conversation. And by the time I got ready to leave, she looked at me and she said, "Do me a favor, would you pray for me?" I said, "Yes, ma'am, I'll be glad to pray for you. And pray for me that I learn how to control my big mouth." So, hey, man, I'm a man of my word. So I knelt and I said, "Lord, I just pray for Barbie. Thank you for letting us meet each other today. And I pray that Barbara would learn how to control her big mouth. And in Jesus' name, amen." There are conversations sometimes that we look at and they are just difficult. And you look at them and you wonder, what do we do with this? Well, this next section is exactly that, beginning verse 6. Listen to what it says. And there was a day when the sons of God, talking about the angels, came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came among them. And listen to what it says. And the Lord said to Satan, "From where have you come?" And Satan answered and said to the Lord, "From going to and forth on the earth, from walking up and down on it." Now remember now, Job is blameless, upright, fears God, flees evil. And then Satan is entered into this conversation in this moment. And if you'll remember what it says in John 10:10 about him, he comes to kill, he comes to steal and destroy. So I don't know about you, but I would think he would just say, "Get away." But that's not what this awkward conversation reveals to us. Look at what he says. And he says in verse 8, and this is the Lord speaking to Satan. The Lord said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job?" For what? To be sifted. To be tested. But wait just a minute. Job is a godly man. Surely God's not going to allow that to touch Job's life. And notice what Satan says to him. He said, God says this, "There's no one like him in all of the earth." And by the way, just so you know that God knows who he is, he repeats the same from verse 1, "A blameless, upright, fears God, turns away from evil." And then Satan answered the Lord and said, "Does Job fear God for no reason?" What's he saying right here? He is saying, hey, you've kind of hedged the bet. He's going to say in just a second, you have protected him. You have done everything for him. Surely that's why he praises you. Listen to the way Satan says this. "Have you not put a hedge of protection around him? His house and all that he has on every side? You have blessed the work of his hands, and his possessions have increased in the land. But stretch out your hand and touch all that he has, and he will curse you to your face." And I'm just going to tell you, it gets harder, not easier. Look at what happens in verse 12. Y'all hang with me. I'm going somewhere. "And the Lord said to Satan, behold, all that he has is in your hand. Only against him do not stretch out your hand. So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord." So whose hand was the next moment about to trickle through? God's. Preacher, you're telling me that we can do everything right? We can praise him. We can be blameless and upright. We can fear God and flee evil. We can worship on a regular basis, and I still can have to deal with struggle? Not according to the local prosperity gospel preachers. They're writing article after article about destiny. You can reach your destiny, but here's the problem. The Word of God teaches destiny different. The Word of God teaches us that our destiny is to die to ourselves and to live for the King. So in this moment, we look at this and we see he is a faithful, righteous man. And some of you have done the right things. You do it the right way. And still trouble comes. So what do we do then? Let's just watch Job. I mean, one of the most painful areas of Scripture starts in verse 13. And it said, "Now there was a day when his sons and his daughters were eating and drinking wine and in their oldest brother's house. And there came a messenger to Job and said, your oxen were plowing and your donkeys beside them. And the Sabines fell upon them and took them and struck down the servants with the edge of the swords. And I alone have escaped to you. Loss number one. Count them with me. Verse 16 is loss number two. And while he was yet speaking, there came another and said, the fire of God fell from heaven and burned up the sheep, and the servants are consumed, and I alone have escaped to tell you. I don't know about y'all, but I would say, I don't need to see any more servants today. But that was only number two. It gets harder. The Chaldeans, this is what it says in verse 17, and while he was yet speaking, there came another and said, the Chaldeans formed three groups and made a raid on the camels and took them and struck them down, and the servants with the edge of the sword, and I alone have escaped to tell you. Number what? Three. And while he was yet speaking, there came another, it said, your sons and your daughters were eating and drinking wine in their oldest brother's house. And behold, a great wind came against the wilderness and struck the four corners of the house. And it fell upon the young people, and they are dead. And I alone have escaped to tell you. Feel that for just a moment. A blameless, upright, God-fearing, evil-fleeing, worshiping man. And just a day, lost it all. Let me ask you a question. Was God God when he possessed it all? Yes. Was God still God when he had lost it all? But aren't you asking the same question as me? And I don't think I'm so much different from you. I look at this text and I just go, God, why did you do that? He was blameless. If anybody deserved your hand of protection, if anybody deserved your favor, it was you. But it's not about Job. It's about the one he worshiped. So notice how Job responds. I mean, to me, it's one of the craziest reactions in all of Scripture. I mean, I don't know about you, but I would have been mad. Anybody else would have thrown a fist up at God and go, God, what are you doing? God, why are you allowing this in my life? Why would you allow this in somebody else's life? You ever walk through a funeral line? Somebody's lost a loved one, and I was just there this past week. I didn't do the funeral, but I came in to see they lost a teenage son, and so it was a friend of a friend, that kind of thing, and so I was walking through the line, and everybody's always trying to explain away these difficult moments, and the lady in front of me made this statement. Have you ever made this? Don't ever do this again. She said, you know, I don't know why God took your son at 17. I just believe, I have to believe in my mind, he just has a garden and he needed another flower to plant in his garden. Guys, we don't need to make excuses for the king. If he is only God on the mountaintop, then he's not a very mighty God. But he is God on the mountaintop and God in the valley, he's an incredible God. And listen to what happens here. I mean, this is absolutely crazy. Look at verse 20. By the way, I promise you, that is not your favorite verse of Scripture. This is not one of those things that you have on a card on your mirror at the house. But listen to what he says. Then Job arose and tore his robe and shaved his head, and he fell on the ground and did what? Worship. How can he do that? I'm not trying to belittle your or my circumstances. I'm not trying to look at the struggle in your life and my life and say, okay, Sarah, what I'm trying to tell you is he is either a God that is completely capable of ministering to you and holding you up and taking you through the valley, or he's not very much of a God. But Job thought he was incredible. In the middle of all of his heartache, he worshiped him. Where did he learn that? Y'all remember what I said to you when we were rolling through this? I'm going to come back to that. Verse 5, it says this. And Job said, it may be that my children have sinned and cursed God in their hearts. Thus he did continually. Did continually what? He worshiped. Far too many of us are waiting to try to worship when the crisis comes. It's too late. Your heart already needs to be aligned with the King. You already need to be praising him. You already need to be singing to him. You already need to say, God, whatever it is, and this ought to be your prayer in all of your worship. What he says next. Verse 21, it says, and he said, naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I shall return. The Lord gives and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. I know some of you are in really tough spots. I know there are young couples who want to have children who haven't been able to, or maybe you've lost a child. Maybe God blessed you with children, you've lost a child. Maybe your child is AWOL. Maybe your child is running from God. You don't know where they are. Maybe you're here in this room and you're dealing with all kinds of different things. Maybe it was your marriage that you thought would last forever, and now it's over. It's your finances. You don't even know where the next bill's coming from. And you're sitting in here and you're trying to say, what do we do in the valley? We praise him. But how? We commit ourselves to be blameless, upright, fear God, flee evil, and commit ourselves to worship. A number of years I learned this the hard way. The real hard way. It was December the 26th, day after Christmas. I got a phone call that said, Pastor, you need to get to Presbyterian right now. There's a really serious situation. So my youth pastor and I were together, so we took off towards the hospital. And I don't know if you've ever been there or not, but I walked in the hospital and I heard this blood-curdling scream from around the corner. So I made my way around the corner. At that time, the doctor was coming out and he looked at me and he said, I am sorry, they really need you. So I pulled back the curtain and I walked in to see one of my best friends and his wife standing there holding their 10-month-old baby who had just died. I walked over and I didn't have anything to say. And I leaned in and I said, I am so very sorry. We just sat there and cried. We just wept. Then the mom turned to me and she said something like this, can you help me? I don't know what to do. And I said, what do you mean, honey? I walked into this place with a baby and I'm walking out of here with nothing. I can't just lay him down there. She asked me to do this. She said, would you hold him till the funeral home comes? The nurse kind of tried to save me a little bit. Well, honey, that could be hours. I just can't leave him alone. So I grabbed little Jacob, had him in my arms. Mama leans into me with tears just flooding down her face and kisses him goodbye. and my buddy Paul that I've known since I was a kid leans in and he kisses his son on the face. And then he said the strangest thing. Sing. I said, excuse me? He said, sing. I said, I don't know what to do. He said, just sing. That old chorus used to sing all the time. Just sing. So holding that little 10-month-old baby, I started singing this old Brook and Tab chorus. Sitting at His feet, sitting at His feet, that is where my life is complete. Sitting at His feet. For about 2 hours, I held that little baby. A few days later, his dad stood to his feet and sang, "When God Sends the Rain." Do you hear this? Did you hear what Job said? "Naked I came from my mother's womb, naked I will return. The Lord taketh and the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away." And it should be an exclamation point. Blessed be the name of the Lord. But it still doesn't answer the question, does it? Why? You know, if you and I live in a way and God takes every little pain out of our life, then guess what? The people around us will never know of God's sustaining grace and mercy. I'm not saying we should pray for the pain, but what I am saying is God, if you bring it, we need to already know what we'll do. We'll praise Him. I know what you're thinking, preacher. That sounds pretty good for you. You've never experienced anything like that. That's not true. Almost 3.5-4 years ago, I was on vacation with my family. Didn't feel real good, so when I got back, my wife said, "Maybe Monday you ought to go see the doctor." And then she told my wife, normally will go behind my back, and she went behind my back, told my doctor at church, and he said, "I'll see you tomorrow at 7 o'clock. So I go in, had been to the gym, was in there, I had an 11 o'clock funeral, and I was going through everything with me, and he did an EKG, and he goes, "Hey, are you feeling bad?" "No, sir." He said, "You're in the middle of a heart attack." I said, I can't be having a heart attack. I've got a funeral at 11. He said, "Yes, it will be yours." So I made my way over to the Sanger Clinic and then rushed to the Sanger Clinic, to the one in Charlotte. They did a cath on me and I had not one, not two, not three, not four, but 5 blockages. My main artery was 100%. At another 90, 270, 150. And then they told me this. "Our only problem is because of COVID, we're 12 days out. I said, "Dude, I think I got 11 days left." By the way, it was my birthday. So for 12 days, I just waited. I prayed. And I fleshed this out in front of my children. Not my church. I love my church. But I fleshed it out with my children. Conversations with my oldest son. "Dad, this is not good, right?" "No, son." My other two children going back to college. And I grabbed them and I hugged them real close. And they said, "Dad, what happens?" What happens if you don't make it? I thought to myself, I've been preaching this almost all of my life. Either I believe it and live it now, or I just give up on it completely. And I just responded with this: blessed be the name of the Lord. But that's not even the craziest part of this text. Look at this last little piece of this text. In all of this, Job did not sin or charge God with wrong. I know what you're thinking, but you don't know what I've been through. I mean, he lost it all. 10 children in a day. All of his resources. All that God had blessed him with. And he didn't count it or charge it to God. I'm not saying your life is easy. And I'm not saying that your struggle is not real. But what I want you to understand is this God is a sustainable God. This is a God that can love you in the mountain and can carry you in the valley. Isn't that what his word says? Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are what? With me. You ever feel sorry for yourself? You ever looked up and said, God, if this is the way it is, I can't love you, I can't serve you? Then you don't know the same God that I know. Because I can tell you, after about 7 or 8 days laying in a hospital by yourself at night and thinking, what am I doing here? And then you start hearing the voice of God, not literally, but you feel him saying, peace, rest, trust me. What you got that you don't want to admit? I'm not talking about, by the way, the sin in your life, the consequences of sin in your life. There are those things that God allows into your life, but they're your responsibility. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about when you do it good, when you're walking blameless, upright, fearing God, fleeing evil, worshiping him, and it still comes your way. Do you trust him then? But to me, it's not the most challenging part of the text. I ran right through it on purpose because I wanted to end with it today. Look with me at verse 8. Y'all say we're there when you're there. There's three of y'all. Verse 8 said, and the Lord said to Satan, listen to these words, have you considered my servant Job? Then listen to the testimony of God himself, that there is none like him on earth. God knew what Job would do. Why? Because he was in fellowship with Job. He saw the way Job lived. He saw his life. He saw his testimony. He heard his worship. What about you? God is having that conversation. Would you be a consideration? Would God look at you and say, hey, that one, test him? I know what y'all are thinking, God doesn't do. No. Listen to what happened here. Satan was roaming looking, and he said, hey, consider my servant Job, for there is none like him in all the earth. We're not the exception. And all of this doesn't give testimony to who Job was. It gives a testimony to who his God is. And all of that, he still had a song to sing. he still had praises to give him. What about you? Satan's roaming. Satan's looking all through this building this morning. He is looking. He comes to steal, kill, and destroy. And he's saying, hey, and God says, test this people. Test this church. Test us. And God, see who we are. So today, what is it that you got? What is it that you bring in here and you're just thinking, I don't understand it. You know, God's going to make good out of it. And he will. He promises that. He will meet you in those moments. I've been there. I know what it's like to be met in the darkest moments of my life and other people's lives. But here's what I know. You have to be in the process of worshiping him and praising him regardless. So that God hears you. I don't know about y'all. When I preached through this the first time, a number of years ago, I got to that verse 8 and it just troubled me. Because here's what I believed. I don't believe God would have said, test him. I don't know that I had enough in me. My church, all of those things, that had been all that I was about. But when you sit for 15 weeks in your house with just you, your Bible, and some songs, you find out how good your God is. So this morning, I'm going to give you an opportunity. Here it is. It's real simple. It's your day to praise him no matter what's happening. Pastor, you don't know what, this hurts. Listen to Job. He tore his clothes, shaved his head, and he fell on the ground and he worshiped. Blessed be the name of the Lord. I don't think there are any more honoring thing today for you to bring whatever it is you're dealing with and just kneel at his altar and just say, God, I praise you. I don't know what to do, but I praise you. Mom, that you think nobody sees, you're not alone. Dad, that you feel like you've messed up, you're not alone. And if you're sitting in this room and you have never given your life to Christ, can I just say something to you? The first real step in your life that will change your life is when you give your heart to him. It's not real complicated. It's just a little scary. But on the other side of that is wonder and the miracle of life change. But what is it today? It's your day to give it back to him and to bless him. They're going to come and lead us in just a second in a closing song, and here's what I want to do. I'm going to just open up this altar. I don't know where you've been. I don't know what you're doing. I'll be standing right over there. Sammy's going to be here in the middle, and whatever it is you're dealing with that you need to come, why don't you come? But you had no idea you were going to be able to lay all that down in this place today. But may we do exactly what Job has done. May we fall on our faces and worship. We said, naked I came from my mother's womb, naked I return. The Lord gives and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Would you come to him? Father, have your way. Not my way. Not anybody else's way. God, may there be people with real pain, real sorrow, real struggle, and they wondered what to do. God, may you turn their sorrow into joy this morning. God, give peace, give direction. But God, more than anything else, God, May you hear us praise you, even in the storm. And it's in Jesus' name we pray.
Thank you for watching Decision for Life. Our location, life group, and program information are available online at fbcit.org. We hope you will take the opportunity to join us in person. Thank you from the family of First Baptist Church, Indian Trail.